Welcome back. Do you ever have the feeling that you meet people and you just know that you're supposed to meet them? Like, it's almost like when we met, yeah. I was like, okay, finally, you showed up. Thanks mm-hmm. for showing up.
I totally feel the exact same way.
So our next guest is one of those people. And how do I know that? Because he has a company called Red Shoes Living. Mm-hmm. This is my very first pair of shoes. And I actually still own them, which is really the crazier part.
Yeah.
But Red Shoes Living is all about living above and beyond mm-hmm. and really just being the best, doing the mm-hmm. best. And so he just felt like somebody who was so overdue, mm-hmm. but I've just been waiting for him. So let me bring him on.
Oh, thank you.
This is Lonnie Mayne.
Thank you.
So nice to meet you. It's great to be with you guys.
Yes, yeah, thanks for the red shoes.
Isn't that crazy? Yes. No, this is fun. And I love the name of your company because it just encapsulates visually what we all want in our lives, right?
Yeah.
We don't want the black shoe living.
It's fun.
Right. We want the red shoe living. Yeah.
So tell us about Red Shoe Living.
So Red Shoes Living, you know, conceptually what it's all about is standing out for the positive in everything you do. From the work that you do, the work that you two do, mm-hmm. to how you live your life. And it's a concept I developed in 18 years of corporate America to try to get the best version of people out of themselves. And in delivering of products and services and the delivery to the customer experience. And then I used it to run a tech company the last 10 years and hiring people. You know, we wanted to hire a very specific kind of individual, somebody that stood out, that was positive, that mm-hmm. was hardworking, that brought people along with them along the way to their success. And it just stuck. It became a very sticky and cool concept for people. So we developed a framework, a very simple framework around it. And now I talk to other companies all over the world about it and work with executives and executive teams. And I think what makes it so interesting to people is people live the concept, the philosophy at home as much as they do it at work.
It really is a lifestyle, isn't it?
It is.
It's not a behavior that you can track here and there. You either are or you're not a Red Shoes Living person.
That's right. Yeah. You know, I was looking at some statistics just the other day, and on average, they say, Gallup actually did some research not too long ago that said 68% of U.S. employees are disengaged in their companies.
Wow. That's really high.
It's high, you know, so 68%. So 32% are engaged and they're innovating and they're working hard every day, and that 68%, which is really the core of the organization, is disengaged in one way or another. So Red Shoes is one way to kind of wake those people up and inspire them to think about work in a completely different way.
How do you do that?
Well, so we created five pillars, and we apply these pillars into four different areas of a company or in a business. And the pillars start with awareness. It all starts with being aware of who's in front of you, aware of a customer, aware of the, you know, the work that you're doing. So awareness is where it starts. Gratitude is the second thing. And Lauren, you and I have talked about when you're a grateful individual, you know, you're more open. And when
you're more open,
opportunities come your way, customers come your way, you work together, you know, it's a very inclusive environment. So that was number two. Number three is everybody has a story. So as we connect, you know, over the next few minutes, we'll learn more about each other's stories. And when you do that, that's how you connect. And if I understand, Amy, your story, then I know how to inspire you. And our stories change for the day. Some days we're happy, some days we're sad, some days we're anxious, some days we're tired. As a leader, as a human being, if I know your story for that day, then I can work with you and motivate you and inspire you and help you. So that's the third one.
I love that.
The fourth one is kindness and respect. And in the business world, I tell people kindness and respect doesn't mean just warm and fuzzy. You know, I'm fiercely competitive. I just don't want to be a jerk about it. And there's lots of great leaders in the world today that are, you know, they command respect, they command accountability, but they're kind. And they're respectful, and they give back, and they develop their employees and bring them along.
It's less about commanding than earning, isn't it?
It is, yeah. And there's, you know, with the different generations now, too. By the way, these five pillars, the four that I've walked through and the fifth one I'll talk about here in just a minute, they go across all generations, you know, and that's what's made it so unique as well. My former technology company that I ran, we had 70%+ of our employees that were millennials. And I get that question all the time, so how do we motivate that generation? And I think they're brilliant, by the way. They work different than I probably do, but I've learned a lot from them. And so this, you know, the pillars really cross those generations. The fifth pillar is putting yourself out there. So the fact that you two wore red shoes today is putting yourself out there.
That's totally. Right. We're supportive already. Yeah.
Totally. Yeah. And thank you for wearing yours.
Absolutely.
Okay,
yeah.
So we've got awareness.
Right.
We've got gratitude.
Yes.
We've got everybody's got a story, respect and kindness.
Correct.
And put yourself out there. There.
Right.
Okay.
So you take those five things, and they become linear and they become cyclical. So I'm using all five of those components with both of you right now. I'm aware, I'm grateful that I'm here. You know, I'm telling you more about my story that I'm learning about your story, but then kindness and respect just has to show up. And then somehow I have to put myself out there for the two of you to create value, and that becomes reciprocal. So we take those five things and we say, let's apply them to leadership. Let's apply them to the company culture of an organization, and we don't go in and take or change culture. We thread this philosophy into the current mission, vision, values of an organization. And then we apply it to the customer experience. And so how we show up for each other, how you've showed up for me as I came on the show, and bottles of water, and Constance that did the makeup, and you know, her communication and kindness with me, that's all red shoes. And then finally, you apply it to the way you live your life. So 24 hours in a day, hopefully we're getting at least 8 hours of sleep at night. I know most of us are not, but you've got 16 hours in the day where you're alive and awake. Eight of those potentially or more, you're at work. Eight, you're at home doing your thing. So if 68% of the U.S. employees at work are disengaged, this philosophy applied to the individual within a business starts to change that disengagement, makes people more engaged. When we're home, the 8 hours that we're home doing our hobbies and, you know, being with friends and what have you, we're pretty engaged. But you apply these five principles of red shoes or the pillars in both halves of your life for 16 hours a day, and you go to bed with it, you wake up and you put those shoes back on and you go to work with it. So it just becomes this way of living life, and and it's a beautiful thing.
I have to believe that for the people who aren't living it yet, for instance, in their whole life, if they're exposed to it in the business place and it starts to infuse and become a part of them, then it will, I mean, have you seen it? Then it kind of spills over into the rest of their life. It has to.
It's hard to describe until you've seen it, but what we did is we designed a 1 hour keynote presentation as an example, and we started with, we want to be able to give something of value back in that 1 hour that people can take and apply it to their lives, that it could potentially change their lives from that 1 hour keynote on. And then we built it out even further. So we go into organizations and work with executives and executive teams, and that work gets a lot more intimate. And what you find is that we're all human. And when you start to break the ego down and you break the walls down, we're all competitive, we all want to win, we want to crush the competition. But there's more meaning to life. There's more meaning to work for many employees than just growing the business and taking cost out and winning deals. You're spending half your life there. So we see people change from CEOs all the way, you know, into the depths of the organization. And then typically what happens is people that have made it to the top at some level, when they really embrace the philosophy, they open up and they start talking and saying, look, can we work one-on-one with you and your team? You know, we're challenged, we're not sleeping 8 hours a night, and we're leading these big teams, and you know, how do we get around that? So we work with people on an individual basis to keep them, you know, alive and inspired and fresh.
Vibrant. That's very interesting. One thing that I noticed, just as you've been explaining these principles, is that they're very other-centered. It's all about like showing up for someone else, being grateful for someone else. How do you break that kind of like me-centered philosophy? How do you like fundamentally change somebody's perspective to be more other-centered?
Yeah, you know, it's a great question, and I have the opportunity of sitting in boardrooms and executive meetings and just observing. So my awareness goes up. Once the concept, once people really get and understand the concept, that awareness becomes very keen. So this is an example: in a meeting, somebody might be disrespectful or unkind to another individual, but you can see the change in them immediately when all of a sudden they realize it. And they're aware of it, and they just take a pause. And if I'm in the room, many times they'll look at me like, oh, I just did that, didn't I? And then the pillars start to kick in on, maybe there's a story there. Maybe that person that you just got upset at has some other story in their life that's creating the behavior in that minute. You know, so people will slow down and really start to connect and say, hey, you know what? I could have handled that so much better. What I really meant to say was this. mm-hmm. but this is how I'm feeling and we're not getting it done. So what's your story? Talk to me about that.
Now that's such a great way to collaborate and work through some, you know, change, mm-hmm. maybe some change management problems and maybe some other, because I think about my own experience and I've had situations in the past where I've been at work and I thought somebody's kind of a jerk. And I'm like, what is their deal? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, they kind of open up through, you know, I always feel like it's like the kill them with kindness type of thing, you know? I'm very aware that I can be annoyingly persistent, but I'm like, as long as I'm nice about it, I'll eventually get through, you know?
Yeah.
And so then after a while, they'll open up and reveal some of their insecurities.
Right.
And so they were kind of being jerks to try to cover up their insecurities. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so it is like, I love what you're saying about being able to open up and really get to what the root of the problem is.
Yeah, and you know, I appreciate you sharing that. And to that point, what's interesting, 60%+ of the data that comes back into our business comes back in the form of a story.
Mm-hmm.
And 60%+ are stories that are happening outside of work. So executives get the concept, they believe in it, they understand mm-hmm. it, they realize they can get that 68% more engaged mm-hmm. by just focusing in on that. They leave the office, they're driving down the road, somebody's broken down on the side of the road.
Mm-hmm.
And the awareness kicks in, the gratitude, mm-hmm. grateful it's not me.
Yeah.
There's
yeah.
clearly a story right. there. Maybe yes. this man or woman is trying to get home to their families, you know, and mm-hmm. kindness and respect makes them stop
mm-hmm.
and putting themselves out there, you know, they start yeah. to change the tire.
Mm-hmm.
So all these stories start to come back, and then those stories are told within the organization. What's interesting to me is that you change. You see the change in leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And with the companies we work for, we actually go mm-hmm. in and start asking, you know, the employees,
mm-hmm.
what are you seeing that's changing within the organization? Because
mm-hmm.
sometimes we work just with the executive team. We thread that philosophy into the company, and all of a sudden employees start going, wow, Lauren's a lot different than she was yesterday. What's
mm-hmm.
happening? There's something
mm-hmm.
different about her and I like it.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is you give people enough space to fly and they will fly.
Mm-hmm.
You still hold them accountable, but you create an environment at least where half their life is positive 9 times out of 10 when they walk in that door
mm-hmm.
and they give you their best. And
yeah.
then they go home and they give their families the best and they give strangers the best. And in a world that's become incredibly negative and noisy with politics
mm-hmm.
and drama and all the things that we read about and see all over the place, this becomes the beacon of change.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some pretty powerful people that subscribe to it and deploy it and honor it.
So what do you say that we write a book about this and then we send it to our political leaders?
Well,
both sides of the fence.
Yeah.
No, but really, this philosophy is amazing.
Yeah.
It is, and it could do so much to change the world that we
live in. And unfortunately, it flies in the face of what we see most.
Yeah.
Because this is the kind of behavior that I don't think is highlighted or spotlighted outside very
mm-hmm.
much. It is going on internally
right.
in
mm-hmm.
many places and in many people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
But even, you know, as a kid, I remember riding in a New York City taxi and my grandfather would tip the taxi driver sometimes more
mm-hmm.
than the fare.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I would ask him why, and he would say, because the man's working a job and
mm-hmm.
if I'm mm-hmm. nice to him, he'll be nice to his wife and his kids, and then they have a better day. And
yeah.
then
mm-hmm.
if they're good and he's good to them, then they can go out and be nice to others and they can buy groceries. And he said, an extra dollar is
it's not
going to hurt
mm-hmm.
us,
yeah.
it's going to help him.
Yeah.
So,
mm-hmm.
you know, those kinds of stories, those kinds of small changes
mm-hmm.
that ultimately is where these
mm-hmm.
CEOs and leaders came from,
yeah.
right? All those
mm-hmm.
little lessons that you're just bringing back. It's kind of
yeah.
like what I tell my clients too. It's like, I'm gonna teach you everything your mother taught you, but you couldn't hear her because
right.
she was your mom.
Right.
But you're gonna pay me to tell you again, you know, exactly
yeah.
what you need to hear. And it feels like you're bringing people back
yeah.
to their core of what they probably already know.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, I always tell people what we're gonna tell you, we've created a philosophy and a framework, but it's not new.
Mm-hmm.
We've all been taught, Lauren, to your point, we've all been taught these things, but that noise gets loud, and sometimes what we're focused on becomes, our world gets smaller, you know, we
mm-hmm.
lose perspective, and because of the noise of the world,
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
literally, you know, we tell people, step outside of the four walls, gain some perspective, sit down with somebody new and have a conversation with
mm-hmm.
them, talk with a competitor,
mm-hmm.
you know, and find out what their view is of the world and what they see, and so we spend a lot of time working, you know, that way. It's been interesting in this work because I'm now doing my life's work, and what's beautiful about it is it's not mine anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, we took the data and we assembled it down to the simplest things mm-hmm. because companies get complex, our personal mm-hmm. lives get complex. Mm-hmm. So when you get lost or the noise gets loud, literally for me, as I walked in here to meet with both of you, I ran through the pillars in my mm-hmm. head going, okay, now make sure you're aware. You know, be respectful, don't talk too much, don't, you know, all these mm-hmm. things start to fire. So you practice that and you get, you know, authentically connected with it. And I will tell you that I've seen companies and leaders and people on the outside of business just do some incredible things with this at the center. So that's what makes it powerful and that's what makes it unique. Sometimes convincing people, as simple as this is, yeah. this is what you need. When everybody's moving as fast as they are, mm-hmm. it's hard to do, but the minute it connects and the stories start to come, you know, through, then people just pause and they mm-hmm. go, wow.
That's well, so cool. And sometimes that kindness piece is a little counterintuitive mm-hmm. because I think sometimes people, and this has happened to me in the past where I've been in teams where people say, you know, like, you're soft. And I'm like, well, don't mistake soft for weak.
Right.
I'm going to be nice to you, but we're still going to get the job done.
Yeah.
And so I think that there is that perception that you're really helping to change in mm-hmm. corporate America where you can still be strong and you yeah. can actually lead better with yeah. kindness.
Yeah. Yeah, people, you know, I have a bite. Mm-hmm. I, you know, in business I have a bite, but I'm aware of that bite. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's applied in the right mm-hmm. moment, but even in that moment, right, people mm-hmm. understand what we're trying to do. There's a respect. You know, mm-hmm. that you have for people when they treat you that way. Mm-hmm. And you don't want to let them down. Absolutely. And you feel mm-hmm. committed to achieving the goals and objectives that are important to them because you also know that they know what's important to you as an mm-hmm. individual. And this is interesting because Red Shoes raises the standard of a leader. Mm-hmm. And you do need to rest and take care of yourself and you know, be fit and eat right, because when you wake up every day, what you're saying is, I'm going to give the two of you my best, and we're mm-hmm. both, you know, or the three of us are focused on this goal or objective, we're going mm-hmm. to achieve it, but I see you as much as you see me.
Mm-hmm.
Let's hold each other accountable.
Mm-hmm. So I'm being told that I need to be aware and respectful of our producers.
And oh no, is it time to go? No! No, we need to do more!
And because we're not done here, we know our viewers are not done here, and we'd love them to be able to learn more about you and Red Shoes Living, so where can they find you?
Well, so our website, www.redshoesliving.com, and then we're on social media in lonnie.mayne, all over the place, as well as Red Shoes Living in all the social channels. So
and
thank
we'll just
you.
Look for the Red Shoes. Well, thank you.
That's right.
We're so happy to have you here. Thank you for being with
us. It's my pleasure. Thank you.
And we'll be right back.